Welcome to Green and Red, scrappy politics for scrappy people. A regular podcast on radical, environmental and anti-capitalist politics. Brought to you by Bob Bazanko and Scott Parker.
Silky Smooth Sounds of the Green and Red Podcast. I am Scott Parkett, your co-host in Berkeley, California today. And as always, I'm joined by...
Bob Bazanko. Today I'm in Niles, Ohio. And we always thank you to begin the show. And if you're watching this on YouTube or, you know, hit the subscribe button, or if, you know, listening to it on your favorite podcast platform, do the same, share, rate and review, all that kind of stuff. And if you have a few extra dollars and like what we're doing, we do have some overhead, so you can always donate if you'd like.
Yeah, and if you, like Bob said, if you like our work and you want to donate or become a patron, check out our website at greenandredpodcast.org and hit the support button. My words are jumbling a little bit today. And then if you want to become a patron, you go to our Patreon page, patreon.com/greenredpodcast, and become a recurring donor. And so today we're going to be talking about the history of capital waging war on radical workers. And we're going to be talking about, we're going to be joined with two guests. We'll be talking about some of their work that they've done on this. Some of this focus will be on some of what the state has done, and some of this will be on what extrajudicial or vigilante type groups have done. And then also we'll probably also talk about private security, private interests as well. And so to start this off, just to do an intro, we're joined by Professor Ahmed White. Professor White is the Nicholas Rosenbaugh Professor of Law at the University of Colorado at Boulder, where he has taught labor and criminal law since 2000. He is the author of The Last Great Strike, Little Steel, The CIO and the Struggle for Labor Rights in New Deal America. And then his current book, which will be out in the fall, is called Under the Iron Heel, The Wobblies and the Capitalist War on Radical Workers. Welcome to Green and Red, Professor White.
Thank you.
And then we're also joined by Professor Chad Pearson, who teaches history at Collin College, a community college in Plano, Texas. He is the author of Reform or Repression, Organizing America's Anti-Union Movement. And he also has been an editor of Against Labor, How U.S. Employers Organized to Defeat Union Activism. And he has published in many different media outlets, including Counterpunch, Jacobin, Labor History, and a number of others. And his book, which will also be out in the fall, is called Capital's Terrorists, Klansmen, Lawmen, and Employers in the Long 19th Century. Welcome to Green and Red, Professor Pearson.
Thank you so much. I'm delighted to be here.
Yeah. And just to maybe kind of kick it off, reading through your book and reading your articles, Professor White, we've seen, I found it interesting that there's this notion of law and order, which actually dates back to the 19th century. And then we also see that in some of the, repression against the Wobblies. And I'm just wondering if we could maybe start off about talking about some of this, like this notion of law and order, and the roots that has in the 19th and early 20th century, and how it was used as a narrative or ideological frame to, you know, go after some of these, after radical unions and other progressive forces.
Sure. So, you know, every society has a mandate to maintain order. And in the modern world, the central way, not the only way, but the central way, the most apparently legitimate way to do that is through law. And there are ways in which that's done that are, you know, beyond any controversy. If some, you know, murderer is on a rampage, then we expect the law to deal with that. And we hope that that'll happen. We hope that there is, you know, some order in the world. It's labor's misfortune, though, and radical labor's special misfortune, that its suppression in this country for well over a century has been thoroughly incorporated into this program of law and order, meaning that For one thing, the government has played through its legal system a very active role in suppressing labor by that method, using law, using police, using legal prosecutions, imprisonment, and so forth to accomplish these purposes. At the same time, though, it's this notion of law and order has also functioned ideologically as a way of justifying all kinds of repression of labor, including things that go beyond or that have gone well beyond legitimate, or what we would regard as legitimate or arguably legitimate legal process, to include things like vigilantism or extra legal actions, or as some of the victims of this often call it, the kind of law, the law of the lawless, used to suppress people and to hold organized labor, again, especially radical workers, in place. So there's a very long history of this. And the one other thing I would say about it that makes it especially problematic for workers, or has made it especially problematic for workers, is the way it often unfolded as a kind of a trap or a prison in the following way, that workers in asserting their rights often found themselves in a position where to play by the rules was to face certain defeat. And at the same time, they often encountered situations where they were very explicitly provoked into acting in illegal ways. And either way, what often happened was that workers resorted to illegal actions, sometimes violent actions, that themselves provided a kind of incontestable justification for the use of state power, or for that matter, vigilantism, to hold them in check. And that thing has kind of repeated itself time and time and time again through the history of American labor. If you do nothing, you lose. If you respond in ways that either were or could be characterized as violent or disorderly, then you also lost, because that triggered a response couched as an act of an assertion of law and order.
You know, I think in general, the left sees repression as a function of the state, but it's more than that, as both of you pointed out. And I know, Chad, in your recent work, you've talked a lot about that. There are also these kind of private forces that work. And I just, I've done a little, you know, my MA's in labor history. So, and I'm near Youngstown. So I was, you know, I was looking some stuff up last night, and this is later, but in the 1930s, Youngstown Sheet and Tube had its own militia with 8 machine guns, 369 rifles, 190 shotguns, 450 revolvers, over 10,000 rounds of ammunition, 109 gas guns, and 3,000 rounds of gas ammunition. So I just wonder if you wanted to talk a little bit about not just the state function and repression, but, you know, especially in the introduction to your new book, Chad, you talk about this too, that it's bigger than that, that you have these terrorists that you call them.
Yeah, I mean, I think that, you know, it's a provocative title. And what I sought to do is to rescue the word terrorism from the Islamophobes, and to, you know, think about how, you know, these folks in positions of power, they control the narrative, they invoke the language of law and order, but really they make the lives of ordinary people, you know, pretty miserable. And they get away with it, right? They have what I call the enablers, right? And so, you know, it's interesting to pose a question. I mean, the police, many police departments emerged in urban centers, and they did the work for employers, right? Then you have groups like the Pinkertons, right? Or and other, you know, security agencies. And what you often see, of course, is these employers, these elites getting their own hands dirty, you know, efficiently going in and breaking strikes, arresting people, that kind of thing. So, and they get away with it. You know, that's the, there's a recent paper that I read in a draft, and the authors of this paper said that there's a, you know, if you look at the press, there's all this coverage about labor violence, but they did a search on employer violence. It's not there. It's not there, you know? So part of how they can invoke this idea of law and order is because they control the narrative, you know?
You know, I'm kind of curious. Both of your works are, you know, focused on both state and extrajudicial violence against labor. But you know, Chad, I think it's the first chapter of your book where you actually talk about the Klan, which is a terrorist organization in post-Reconstruction in Reconstruction South, and you make an argument that actually the Klan is also like a bosses association. I'm wondering if you could just like talk about that for a moment.
Certainly. I think, so when we think about race and race relations, the Klan, there are all these civil rights groups who like to talk about hate organizations. Well, I don't think hate as a sort of a unit of analysis is appropriate here. I think it's better to think about exploitation because, you know, what did the Klan want? What sort of vision did they have, right? They wanted African-Americans to shut up and take it, to work the fields, to work, you know, to do nothing but work, not, you know, get an education or vote or, you know, get involved in one of these union leagues. So the Klan itself, the leadership tended to be elites, landowners, merchants, lawyers, and they sought to force those former slaves who enjoyed that new freedom to get them back to the farms and back to the plantations. And you can look at the documentation. Now, researching the Klan or any of these groups is very difficult because they're hyper secretive. But there are documents that very explicitly state, you know, you do your job, you do your work, we're not going to bother you, right? And so there's lots and lots of evidence. Now, it's an imperfect argument because there are cases of, say, labor competition that is, you know, working class white folks, you know, chasing away African-American laborers. But the leadership and most evidence that I have seen suggests that we should really have a class analysis and to recognize that the folks at the top of society called the shots. They, you know, they're involved in politics, they're involved in vigilantism. So I think the evidence is there to really support this notion that the Klan was sort of a pre-industrial employers association.
You know, you mentioned class analysis, which I think is something that I try to talk about too. And especially on the left, when you talk about the state, it tends to focus on things like police attacks on African-Americans, more recently attacks on immigrants. And one thing I like to point out is the ruling class kind of will destroy anybody whose interests, you know, who challenges its interest, and that will include, you know, white workers. And so the most sustained period of labor violence is really from like what, around 1877 to the Little Steel Strike. You have that 60 years where it's really class war. And I just wonder if both of you would want to say a little bit more about that, because I think that's really kind of right now a big debate on the left, an argument on the left, right? This idea of class versus whatever you want to call it, wokeness or identity or whatever. And I think earlier on, did workers themselves have a sense of class consciousness and of acting as a class in response to the repression of the state and these private actors?
Sure, I think workers absolutely did. It was something that couldn't be denied in that period you describe in particular. Hundreds and hundreds of people were killed in these clashes. The great majority of them workers. It was just something again that was completely undeniable. And to connect that to your first question, the first part of your question, I think it's crucial to understand the class functions of the modern state. And that is something that is at risk if the discourse is so completely and utterly dominated by issues of race or gender and all that. That's important. We can all acknowledge that. But what has gotten to a significant degree written out of story about the state and its functions in the modern world is this role in class repression. And one way you can see that is in the way we talked about the Constitution and civil liberties as they relate to labor repression. One thing I've seen very consistently in my own work and a lot of work in this field that doesn't get a lot of attention is the way that our tolerance as a society for dissent on the part of workers and labor is almost entirely dependent on whether those workers are threatening anyone's interest or important values. If they're not, then it turns out the courts have a tendency to be quite tolerant, to extol the virtues of free speech and freedom of association and all of that. But the moment that those workers become threatening to the interest and values of powerful people, then those civil liberties yield. And it's not for nothing that that some of the sort of more liberal champions of labor rights in the 1920s and 1930s, like the La Follette Committee that investigated labor violence in the 1930s into the early 1940s, were completely preoccupied with labor as a question of freedom of speech and freedom of association, because they understood that.
I would add just more broadly on the race versus class issue, which seems to never really go away. There's this assumption in some circles that labor history is the history of white men in unions. And of course, that's not true, right? I mean, the history of labor is very diverse, gender-wise, race-wise, sexual orientation-wise. And so, if you look at power relations and you think about, you know, the importance of, biracial strikes, which, you know, there's not a whole lot of, that hasn't really captured the popular imagination in the way, say, the 1619 Project has, right? Or, you know, another issue is sort of Black elites, Booker T. Washington. You know, there was a long time when there was a fair amount of scholarship about, you know, Black elites and anti-unionism. A lot of that stuff is not so much in the, you know, discussed in the same way. And I would also, you know, insist, you know, thinking about the Klan, the Klan, they wanted the African-American masses to labor on the farms, on the plantations. And who they really disliked were these white teachers, right? They sought to drive them out, right? There was a place for African-Americans. There was no place for, you know, these you know, white so-called carpetbaggers and whatnot. So, you know, this issue, race versus class, isn't going away. I guess the best way to respond is to, you know, put these things into context.
You know, my question would be, like, thinking about these extrajudicial groups, what's the Klan, whether it's the Klan or the Law and Order Committees or the Citizens Alliances, and, you know, you're talking about how, I mean, you talk about how the elites are actually lead some of the mobs, but I'm also kind of wondering how the elites were able to also, how the elites leveraged, you know, people who were more of like working class backgrounds, you know, with whether, you know, around racial lines, it makes sense because they were able to play into like racism, but like when they were going after like the Wobblies or like, you know, white radicals, I'm just kind of curious about what the sort of leverage was they used to convince them to go after that, after those entities.
If I may, one of the things that you see in the early 20th century are the development of these paradoxical sounding anti-labor union unions, right? So these are, you know, it sounds oxymoronic, right? You've got a, you know, the independent order of labor, the Free Labor Association, right? And so they mobilize, they being the elites, mobilize workers into these anti-union leagues. Now, it's difficult to know how sincere the workers in these organizations were, because there's a problem with, you know, sources, you know, evidence. So, you know, there's always been, you know, strike breakers, scabs and whatnot. I think there are lots of different scenarios. There are cases where you have the strike breakers don't know they're heading to a strike, and they get there and they're like, oh, you know, well, I'm already here, I guess I got to do it. There are others who turn around. There are others who sort of, you know, might be true believers in, you know, anti-union ideas. So it's hard to kind of generalize. But what I say, you know, in my book, for the most part, we're looking at elites. They're the ones who are engaged in the kidnapping raids. They're the ones who are engaged in the drive-out campaigns, that sort of thing. And how many sort of working class people are in these organizations? Hard to say, but my sense is not a whole lot.
So go ahead.
Oh, and if I just, you know, might add, another important way that this kind of this opposition to workers was was generated and rationalized was through the rhetoric and the politics of patriotism and militarism. So I think it's important not to focus too much on the so-called Red Scare periods, the first one in the 1920, and then the Little Red Scare in the late 1930s, and the second Red Scare, so-called, in the 40s and 50s, because there was plenty of repression in between those periods. But those are important nonetheless because they emphasize exactly the way that patriotism and militarism and issues of state security could be used to mobilize people, that this is a real threat. And you combine that with the politics of race, the politics of ethnic competition and tension and conflict. And it was a pretty effective formula for mobilizing people against workers. Not for nothing was the American Legion, for instance, almost from its inception, a very active force in organizing anti-labor violence, including, for instance, the so-called Centralia massacre in November of 1919, where Wobbly was lynched after an attack on their Union Hall, and that was spearheaded by a group of American legionnaires.
I think it's such an excellent point, and just, I'm sorry.
No, go.
The open shop principle, the idea that you don't need to be a member of a union to work in a workplace, right? This is a sort of powerful ideological campaign. In the era just after World War I, the employers and their allies referred to it as the American plan. The American plan, right? That is that you're equating America, the open shop system of industrial relations with patriotism, right? And so they're very explicit on that issue.
Something you brought up earlier, and I want to kind of think it's important. Because in general, and if you read, like Howard Zinn's book, which is wonderful, but I think somewhat romantic, the focus tends to be on these violent acts, these terrorist acts, but the ruling class has kind of countless strategies it can use. And you mentioned earlier things like the media and the courts. I just wonder if you could talk a little bit more about that, because, if you look at American protest history, it's really not as violent as many other places, especially, on the side of labor and the left. And the ruling class in many ways doesn't have to, right? It can, and it will. And in 1877, it did in 1886 and so on, but it has other strategies. It has countless strategies. Do you want to talk a little about that? Because I think that's really important in understanding the way, oligarchic power works.
Me? Yeah, okay, sorry. I think, Ahmed could probably speak to this with greater detail, but I mean, in terms of injunctions, right, you have tons and tons of injunctions that stop workers from protesting. In terms of the media, I mean, I mentioned, the newspapers had plenty of coverage of labor violence, but didn't cover employer violence. And then you have novels, right? Doing my research, there are all these anti-labor novels and novelists who are able to shape the consciousness of people about labor. So why if you have this infrastructure, right? You've got the press, you've got the courts, you've got the politicians. Why engage in direct combat? And I think because they could, and it might be more efficient, right? I tell a story about this guy Hugo Donzelman. There's a big strike in Cheyenne, Wyoming, and he brags. He says, did we wait for the injunction law? Not us. We went down there, 460 of us with our guns, and we told those workers step aside, and they stepped aside, right? This is the these are powerful people, right? They're employers, they're legal experts, and he was the first attorney general of Wyoming. This guy, right? So he could have gotten an injunction, right? But he just goes down there with his guns, right? And so I think maybe they want to flex their muscles. Maybe they enjoy the adrenaline rush of direct combat. Some of these people were involved in Indian War. Some of these people were involved in the Civil War. There's the camaraderie of those earlier battles that they might want to kind of relive. It's hard to say for sure, but you know, they've got the institutions, they've got the media, and then they also like to get their hands dirty.
It's a bit like some of these Republican politicians who went to the Capitol riot. Is right. What that made me think of.
Yeah.
And you also have to ask the question, what do we mean by violence? You know, a lot of workers back then talked about the violence of the master class in a way that encompassed not only overt violence, the way we were talking about it a minute ago, but the implicit violence of arresting people, of locking them up in local jails, of putting them in prison, and all of that, which was ubiquitous. I mean, several thousand people were put in prison, leftists of one sort or another, between say 1877 and 1937, and countless tens of thousands were thrown in jail. You'll never get a reliable estimate of that number, because it was just so common to arrest people, charge them with vagrancy or disorderly conduct or no particular charge at all. You see these old police records and blotters, general suspicion or something like that. And, you know, that's a kind of violence in its own right that I think has been understudied in the literature. When you talk about taking someone, stripping them naked, subjecting them to all these indignities, and then locking them up for, it might be 3 days, it might be 10 days, it might be 3 months, in some god-awful jail somewhere, incommunicado, serving them bad food, subjecting them to the potential and sometimes the reality of sexual assault or whatever, all these bad things that then as now could happen to people who are locked up in jail. That has enormous deterrent effect that I think we can't deny. That's what jails are for, to deter people from engaging in bad behavior. And it is one thing if you're deterring them from, again, committing murder or stealing someone's property or assaulting them for no good reason. But it's quite another thing when that machinery of deterrence is deterring workers from developing and asserting a class consciousness.
Yeah. And Ahmed, your new work is focusing, I think, on the IWW a lot, and they kind of stand out. You know, the history of labor is often kind of couched in terms of like business unionism and Gompers and the AFL and all that. The Wobblies are very different. And you know, what was that based on kind of an ideology or the realities of, you know, lumber camps and mining, you know, mines and things like that? And why was there such a gap between them and much of the other rest of labor? You know, most labor kind of stays away from them. Obviously, the AFL is a craft union. They just want to, you know, hire, you know, they want more money. So what's the IWW's role in this? Because I think they're very important in kind of and also to kind of follow up, if you want to follow up on that, they also lead to a real shift and a kind of a crackdown in terms of the law. So you see kind of a new body of labor law emerge because of groups like the Wobblies.
Yeah, so the thing that strikes me most about the Wobblies and their experience was how true they were to their belief that the state and its legal system was their implacable enemy. They brooked, I won't say no compromise, but almost no compromises. They never did do the things that some other prominent representatives of the American left did, and that is to resort to a kind of opportunism regarding the state that you saw in with respect to the Communist Party and the Popular Front period, for instance, and its alliances with the New Deal State and the CIO and all of that. The Wobblies never really did do that. And, you know, there are probably a number of reasons for that, to beginning with the demographics of the organization. It was mainly, not entirely, but mainly composed of people on the margins. People who back in the teens and 20s couldn't vote anyway, given the realities of voting laws and their lack of permanent residency and all of that. Didn't have, many of them, a permanent home, weren't established in a community, and maybe were in a position for those reasons to better understand the state and see it for what it was. And that, of course, brought down upon them this, the most vicious of repression. One of the things I say in my book is that the one thing they proved above all else by their own subjugation was the essential truth of the philosophy they embraced from the outset. If they accomplished anything, it was to prove that they were fundamentally right about the state, about the capitalist state, and what it was bound to do to people like them, because it did. And I think in some ways, and I don't mean to belittle the suffering these people endured, which I find quite extraordinary, the courage they showed in the face of this. But the one thing they did was to show by their own experience that they were right about what the state was. And I don't say that to say that therefore their approach here was necessarily the correct one, that they were incontestably right about how to confront capitalism, how to organize workers successfully. That's a different issue, a more complicated issue. But they proved what the state was.
Chad, do you want to say a few things about the kind of distinctions within labor also, or whatever, if you had something else?
You know, I want to pick up on something that Ahmed said, if you don't mind, about the incarceration. I think you're absolutely right about the role, the repressive role of incarceration. But on the other hand, right, when you think about unions like the Western Federation of Miners, right, they were brought together, right? They formed this union, at least in part, because they were in these horrible bullpens in northern Idaho, right? And they plotted, they planned together. And so they, out of that repression, they were able to unite and build something else. And, you know, we could also talk about, say, Eugene Debs, right? His incarceration in Pullman, he read Marx, right? And that helped, enhance his sort of understanding. But on the question of the Wobblies, I'm very much in agreement with Ahmed White. I think that's a fantastic analysis. And that is that they understood that the capitalists and workers did not have the same interests. And their experiences illustrated that very dramatically.
This is Scott from the Green and Red podcast. We know you listen to us for environmental politics and anti-capitalist politics, but we also love to do episodes on culture. We've done episodes on sports and activism with Dave Zirin, left-wing country music, comic books with comrades, the Socialist Sopranos, and of course, cancel culture.
And we have a lot more coming up. And this is Bob from Green Red Podcast, and kind of giving you a little bit of a teaser here. Look forward, coming up soon, we will be doing shows on themes like the best political movies, the most radical movies, best political TV shows. Of course, we'll talk about protest music. We're going to have a great show where we talk about the politics of Johnny Cash. We will be discussing the Many Saints of Newark, because we love talking about pop culture and the way politics kind of weaves in with it. So come for the hardcore politics and organizing and history, but stay for the movies and the TV shows, get some popcorn, and make sure you listen to us and share and subscribe. And this could be your one-stop shopping for all your political and organizing and TV and movie recommendations as well. You won't need Netflix anymore. You can just get it from us. So thank you.
I'd be kind of curious your thoughts on, you know, that there's like a model of like state repression where we see the criminal syndicalism laws, and there's the model where we see the extrajudicial violence, vigilante violence. But then there's also this element, I think, around like progressive forces, as it was called then, or progressivism, as it was called then. I call it liberalism today, which actually also, you know, did this sort of softer repression, this watering down of messaging, this compromise, versus like a more no compromise position. I'm just wondering your thoughts on that.
On the question of liberalism, liberals and industrial relations at this time, I think that liberals, progressives, were very much in support of employers and accepted the logic of the open shop principle. That is the idea that workers should have the freedom to not join a union. And we see this with people like Louis Brandeis, Theodore Roosevelt. And this is one thing that that drives me nuts. And that is that there's a failure to acknowledge in academic circles the extent to which these people, Brandeis, Roosevelt, and others, really helped facilitate the the repression of workers. But of course, they cloak their language in you know, sort of progressivism. And Ahmed's written a wonderful article looking at this in the 1920s and beyond that you know, speaks to this, what do you call it, the hard edge of progressivism.
Yeah. You're too kind, because I think your earlier work, your book on this was, I think, fantastic and extremely influential and extremely important. And I think that's a crucial point about progressives and progressivism, who, and the progressives, by the way, were very much behind the enactment of criminal syndicalism laws of the 1917 Espionage Act, something in the news today with the potentially impending extradition of Julian Assange to face charges under that statute. But they were quite inclined, many of them anyway, as a contradictory movement, and some of them were stronger on the question of civil liberties and the rights of dissent than others, but many of them were very much at the center of the move to criminalize radical. At the same time that, again, I think Chad's absolutely right that they were also, and your question, Scott, is right in presuming this, they were also very adept at incorporating this with or alongside a softer forms of control of labor that culminated in, you know, the 1935 Wagner Act, the National Labor Relations Act. That in many ways was proved to be a kind of fist in the velvet glove for workers.
This is a little bit of an academic question, and I know Chad, you and I have talked about this, but you know, long ago when I was in grad school, I read like Coco and Weinstein and Martin Sklar about the role of the state in kind of creating reform in order to contain groups like radical labor. And I don't think anybody is, do people read that anymore? I don't know if they're really even aware of it, but I just wondered if you think that still has value to kind of understand the need for stability and harmony and capital and how that leads to, or can lead to reform. I mean, just the other day, the Republican Party is creating kind of an alternative to the Chamber of Commerce because the Chamber of Commerce is now too woke and too liberal for them, so.
Right. I think that there is still value there. I think from a scholarly perspective, if you look at the academy, most folks who are in privileged academic positions downplay that stuff, denounce it. And I think a lot of it has to do with this focus on, you know, these former labor historians become political historians, and they're so interested in the rise of the right and the tensions between Democrats and Republicans and sort of official politics. And so they see that earlier, you know, new left interpretations as, you know, not as passe and not worth engaging with. But I think there's still value there. You're right. I mean, I think that if you look at the role of liberals in official positions, they are very much involved in anti-radical efforts and efforts to stabilize things and ultimately serve the interests of the ruling class.
Well, certainly, and of course, I teach in law school where privilege abounds, and that's reflected in I think the general attitudes of most law professors. They identify upwards with the elite, and in some respects, they are themselves part of the elite. Things are changing a little bit, I think, not so much among the professoriate, but. I see a change among the students, and I think that reflects maybe the sort of declining ability of the political system and the legal order to legitimate themselves. And that, I think, is related to the fact that we got a lot of people at all levels of academia now, who face declining opportunities, in increasing cost and burdens, and it's putting them in a different position in the world. And that's not the only way to gain a consciousness about these things, but it certainly often nudges people to think differently about the world. And it's insofar as it's things are very different today than they were, say, in 2000. I think there is maybe a renewed relevance for the kinds of works you mentioned. And of course, for the likes of us, their relevance has never has never really diminished, but we'll see.
Very popular on the Green and Red podcast. I'll say that.
That's one of our key themes, is to go after liberals. So like, kind of to follow up on that and to kind of specifically talk to your 2016 book, the Wagner Act and FDR kind of seem to be the high points in labor history in a lot of ways, but that was kind of temporal, wasn't it? Like, you have this brief flurry, FDR wants labor votes, labor contributes heavily to his campaign. But after that, you know, he kind of steps back. And so I think that's important as well, because, you know, especially in the last few years, like Biden, remember, tried to affect the FDR thing. Obama tried to pretend he was the new FDR. But even FDR wasn't really FDR, was he?
No, he absolutely was not. And that was made tragically evident in the Little Steel Strike, when, you know, 16 or 18 workers were killed in the course of this vicious and bloody strike that was completely, by the terms of the Wagner Act, which was enacted a couple years before the strike occurred, unlawfully provoked by these powerful steel companies. They flouted their obligations under the Wagner Act, knowing that, intending that this would provoke a strike, and then they brought to bear the kind of weaponry that you mentioned Youngstown Sheet and Tube had on hand. The other companies had similar stockpiles, and they killed all these people, or they relied on the National Guard or local police to do their bidding for them. And in the midst of all of this, you know, the CIO fairly begged the Roosevelt administration to intervene on their behalf. Francis Perkins and Roosevelt himself, and the New Deal governors in the key states, Martin Davey in Ohio, playing a lead role in this regard. And they, for the most part, got nothing. In fact, Roosevelt quite famously pronounced this a plague on both your houses, allowing the Steelworkers Organizing Committee of the CIO to lose that strike and lose it decisively. And that, you know, again, it's not the only evidence of where Roosevelt and his administration stood on labor rights. How opportunistic they were relative to New Deal labor. It's not the only evidence of that, but you would look hard to find clear evidence of where the Roosevelt administration stood with respect to organized labor.
And wasn't the AFL also kind of in some ways kind of challenging? I mean, in some ways, didn't the AFL and the NLRB work in hand in hand to kind of contain the CIO and more radical kind of labor elements?
Yes, of course, the AFL was a bitter rival of the CIO in that period, and did whatever it could to undermine the CIO and use the government to that end. The story with the NLRB is an interesting one. It's, you know, the agency still exists. Back then, it was led by a three-member board, and now it's five members. Those three members are really interesting because two of them were possibly fellow travelers, certainly strongly on the left. And the third guy, who was the chair of the board when the Little Steel Strike occurred, was a conservative guy, but an interesting kind of conservative of the sort you don't see much anymore. He strongly sympathized with organized labor in this context, and he took no guff from these employers. Well, you know what happened to them. Within a few years, they had all been replaced by more compliant board members who changed the character of the board. And that went in line with the change in the New Deal. New Deal never was, as we all know, a Marxist front in the way that many liberals and conservatives back then and even today argue. But it was peppered with people who were, again, fellow traveler types and so forth. And one thing, again, that happened with the NLRB and happened to other agencies was that they were purged of these folks. And, you know, Roosevelt was fine with that, as were other prominent New Dealers. And the end result was that by the early 1940s, the NLRB was fairly active in suppressing labor rights, particularly when they were asserted in militant ways by explicitly leftist unions. So there's a, you know, there's basically a story here that we all think about Taft-Hartley as being this sort of this revolutionary attack from the right on the edifice of New Deal, of liberal, super progressive New Deal labor law. Well, the problem with that story is that it's only partly true, because a lot of the things that Taft-Hartley did codify had already been done administratively by the NLRB or by the courts.
Oh, no, it's just, you know, on the question of the Memorial Day massacre. I mean, there's really no accountability for these cops who slaughtered these people, right? I mean, it's, you know, so many today, you know, many, you know, liberals, even some leftists, will look back at the 1930s and sort of pepper over, you know, the Memorial Day massacre, or, you know, ignore the Smith Act, which was also, you know, signed by Roosevelt, right? I mean, there's, you know, I don't want to sound sort of ultra left here, but there's, you know, really some anti-labor things going on at that time. And so
it's okay to be ultra lefty.
Yeah.
Actually, I'm glad you brought that up, because, and this is delicate, and I always kind of get somebody pissed off at me, but when people talk about the police today attacking immigrants or attacking African-Americans, which is horrific, right? But I would say, yeah, but they'll go after anybody who gets in their way. And I always mention the Memorial Day massacre or just the labor wars. And I think that, you know, the left has to understand that, you know, white privilege, even white privilege, has its limits. Like, if you're out striking, they'll shoot you. And I mean, I've talked to people here long ago who were veterans at a little steel strike in Youngstown, who said, you know, one guy said an 18-year-old national kid in the National Guard was shaking and holding a rifle at him, and it terrified him, you know. But I think that also gets to the one of the big questions on the left is, like, why isn't there more of a radical tradition in the US? Why is there no socialism? Why was there never a labor party? And I think when you call capital's agents terrorists, I think that speaks to that. But do you want to kind of, like, we're going for the big question here. Why, you know, you did have movements, you had the IWW, you had other labor unions, you had the Germans at Haymarket, you had the Italian anarchists, but that's always kind of a fairly minor part of the overall, you know, kind of direction of labor. So why isn't there socialism in America, Chad?
Well, you know, I mean, it's yeah, there we go. you know, I think a combination of repression, co-optation, you know, thinking sort of broadly. One thing we didn't talk so much about is the role of blacklists, right? Particularly in the 1880s and 1890s, these really terrified workers, right? I mean, you have thousands of people who are blacklisted and unable to get jobs, and, you know, really living in impoverished conditions. It's scary, you know. Ahmed brought up the incarceration. I mean, that's huge. And so, you know, what I try to show in my book is that, you know, you might have these sort of spectacular strikes, and then the ruling class with their enablers come at these people really hard. And you can't dismiss that, right? I mean, I think that's pretty scary. Even soft forms of repression, right? Like blacklisting, book burning, you know, these things matter.
Yeah, someone in my family was a president of a steel mill that went on strike in the 80s or early 90s. And that mill shut down, you know, was taken over by kind of Bain Capital or somebody. It took him about 2 years to find a job locally, because everybody knew he had been the leader, you know, of that strike many years earlier. So that kind of stuff clearly is still there. You know, when we interviewed Stott and Linda a long time ago, one thing that he was really felt strongly about was that in the 30s, these unions started making contracts where they kind of put in, they agreed to no strike clauses in exchange for collective bargaining. And, you know, that's often portrayed as like kind of a pro-labor development. But in fact, I just wonder what you thought of that as well, like the way even the CIO negotiated, you know, in the 30s.
Well, I guess, you know, what you're doing is you've got stewards who are not connected to the rank and file, and you've got these unions become more bureaucratic, and that kind of depoliticizes the labor movement quite a bit, I think, you know. And so there is a case to be made for, you know, a labor movement before the New Deal, right? Which is, you know, yes, tons of repression, but it's also you know, more participatory, you know, good examples of rank and file activism, that kind of thing. So, yeah.
Yeah, and you know, there's of course the old story about the bureaucratization of the labor movement and the professionalization of it. That when you create a movement led by professional people, they tend to do what professionals do, and that's to embrace the kinds of values and institutional responses that are inherent in professional life. That means lawyers, that means contracts, that means playing by the rules, that means all of that. And so it seems quite natural that that this is the course that the labor movement has taken, and not say it was inevitable, but that it seems a natural outcome of the New Deal order as it emerged, that's what we would kind of be stuck with. And I agree with Chad, there are a lot of factors here. There's the kind of rise of consumer society and the way that sort of lays hold to people and the way it supports a kind of bread and butter approach to unionism. And all of that. There's the decline of fraternal orders and things like that that were kind of an underpinning of labor organizing of immigrant ties to other radical traditions. You mentioned the physicalianist and that sort of thing. So there's a lot going on there. But I would agree with Chad that at the forefront here, some of these realities,
then you have labor leaders who, you know, like Sidney Hillman, who say, you know what, we're gonna support the Democratic Party. We're not gonna mess around with any kind of third party, that sort of thing. Which I think organized labor still suffers from that, frankly, right? I mean, this dependence on the Democratic Party. I mean, year after year. I mean, density rates continue to go down. You know, politicians will promise all sorts of things. You know, I mean, I think union density went down faster under Obama than it did under Baby Bush.
It reminds me of Lucy in the football, right? The Democratic Party and Labor thinks that they're going to hold it, and they fall on their ass again. So, when I teach, I actually teach a class in kind of protest history, radicalist, or whatever you want to call it. And there's clearly, I think, a decline in labor militancy after Little Steel. And I'm just curious what you think of this, but the two kind of main factors to me are the Red Scare, but also military Keynesianism, because I think there is generally just kind of this kind of increase in standard of living. I mean, like guys in Youngstown, you know, made good money. They could buy a house. They could send their kid to college. They could take a vacation. Until 1978 or something like that. But I just wonder, like, what you think accounted for that change. You know, part of it I think you brought up was the kind of allegiance to the Democratic Party, which in the long term, and I know Scott wants, after I'm done, Scott wants to talk about that a little bit, contemporary politics and neoliberalism. But what do you think accounted for kind of that shift after kind of the Little Steel period, World War II?
Well, you put your finger on it with military Keynesianism, military history more broadly. You know, we forget often the United States emerged from the Second World War, not just a preeminent industrial power in the world, but I think American manufacturing accounted for half the output in the world. And so that made it feasible to do what was done in the two decades or so after the war, which was to fund this settlement between a good fraction of the American working class and very powerful, highly subsidized, in some ways sort of semi-nationalized American corporations. And it was great as long as it lasted, great in a sense, mm-hmm. in supporting the rise of untold millions of people out of these very marginal existences into something approaching middle-class comfort. And I don't mean to denigrate that at all. It's very significant to people who were impoverished to find some material comfort in life. But it was employed by the big unions as a kind of carrot in co-opting people and blunting militancy. And again, it lasted as long as it lasted, and then until the 1970s, 1980s, it all starts to unwind in the face of things like international competition and inflation, something familiar to us now again. But is often forgotten, that was met, that unwinding in the 70s, by a great tide of labor protest. That workers didn't take it lying down, but it came to naught, in part because of the kind of leadership that they got, in part because the labor movement by then was in this, as Mike Davis, you know, sort of famously put it, in a locked in this barren marriage with a Democratic Party that had less and less use for the labor constituency anyway. And so out of that emerged what we have today, as Chad noted earlier, these abysmally low union density rates in a context where the labor movement's still funneling hundreds of millions of dollars to the Democratic Party. And there's sort of, you know, this furtive hope that at some point, some person's gonna be elected who is somehow gonna do what's never been done before, gonna overturn Taft-Hartley, gonna do all this other, enact the PRO Act, the EFCA, whatever it is, that's gonna somehow happen. So what hasn't happened for getting on 80 years now, 70 something years, is one day it's gonna happen, sort of waiting for Guffman, a moment is gonna come, and it just hasn't.
I know, Scott, you had, I've been monopolizing. I could talk for like 5 hours with you guys about this because it's really fascinating or something. So, but I do have one last question after Scott. So,
yeah, my question is just around kind of more current events. My day job is I work in the environmental sector and work in a lot of organizing and movement organizing sectors. And so thinking about the criminal syndicalism laws against the Wobblies, but then also the extrajudicial forces. It's like, you know, we're seeing like in environmental world, we're seeing like after Standing Rock, we're seeing lots of anti-pipeline protest bills in many states. And we're also seeing, you know, federal prosecutions and state prosecutions of people who were involved in the 2020 uprising. We're actually having a show next week about with someone who does legal support for those folks. And so we have this sort of like state, at least state level, not quite federal, but like state level repression. And then we also have, you know, very much in the news, particularly right now around the January 6th hearings, we have, you know, these extrajudicial groups, the Proud Boys and the Oath Keepers. And I'm just wondering if both of you could comment a little bit on just like how you see, you know, this period 100 years ago, further back, you know, how it parallels with what's going on today.
So if I may, I think, you know, January 6th is a good example of you've got, you know, mostly fairly privileged, you know, business owners, CEOs, you know, engaging in this direct campaign. And I sort of drew some parallels there with the, you know, earlier folks. Of course, this wasn't an anti-labor movement, but certainly these people probably don't like labor. You know, they believe in racial and class hierarchies. Tend to be pretty privileged. You know, they didn't have many enablers and positions of power, but they, you know, they certainly felt confident doing this, right? When they went in, they were asking the cops to join us. They certainly liked the cops, you know, they felt entitled. And even, you know, some of these folks who were arrested, they're like, why are you treating me like a Black person, right? I mean, they couldn't understand, you know, you know, so it gives you a sense of their sort of a entitlement. But I mean, you look at some of these Oath Keepers and the Proud Boys. I mean, they're, you know, upper middle class folks living in McMansions. You know, they're this is not, you know, there's a tendency, I think, to say, you know, all these like reactionary Archie Bunker types, you know, but these are, you know, fairly privileged folks who do a lot of harm and feel entitled and sometimes get away with it.
Bob calls them the lumpen oligarchy.
Yeah, well put.
Like Mike Lindell is the head of that. So.
You know, and one of the ironies there, which kind of parallels what I said earlier about the dilemma labor faces with violence, is, and in saying this, I don't mean to overemphasize the importance of court decisions, but one of the ironies here is that a casualty of 9/11 of January 6th may be the legal protections that people on the left, that we all as Americans enjoy, such as they are, the constitutional protections we enjoy now, unlike in the early 20th century, from being prosecuted for acts of rebellion that aren't violent or imminently violent. So you hear a lot of talk now about Brandenburg versus Ohio, the 1969 US Supreme Court decision, that concerned the Ohio criminal syndicalism law. Now, the defendant in that case was some pathetic young, I think he was a young guy, Klansman, who who filmed himself, you know, berated Black folks and Jews and all this stuff. But the Supreme Court finally in that case gave some real teeth to the clear and present danger test that had been devised decades earlier, but up until that point had done as much to justify prosecuting wobblies and communists as it did to limit the prosecution of wobblies and communists. And there's a wonderful irony there. The Supreme Court was under the leadership of Earl Warren. Earl Warren in 1920, when he was a new district attorney in Alameda County, Oakland, he said on his first day on the job, he prosecuted a criminal syndicalism case. A case involving a guy named John C. Taylor, who was a former wobbly and a founder of the Communist Labor Party. And he claimed, oh, I didn't do very much in the case. That's not clear at all. But regardless, here you go, fast forward to 1969, and Earl Warren leads the court in saying, look, we can't do this anymore. There has to be a robust test of the interest of the state before the state prosecutes people for advocating militant things. That precedent is very much at risk today, in part because many liberal jurists and political commentators don't like it. And I can tell you the reason they don't like it isn't limited to the potential that it creates for difficulty in prosecuting the January 6th rioters, but is much more comprehensive than that. And it goes to the point that we all in different ways made earlier or observed earlier about the position of progressives, today's liberals, when it comes to any kind of radicalism.
Another kind of contemporary question. For what, about a year or so now, we've seen pretty good, you know, run of success among like Starbucks and Amazon workers. But we're talking often, you know, 15, 20 employees. It's not like steel workers and auto workers where you had hundreds of thousands, right? Just wondered, you know, kind of what you thought of that. I mean, it's obviously not a bad thing, but does it have any larger meaning or give us hope?
I think the it's pretty inspiring. I mean, the first Starbucks in North Texas is literally, you know, a few buildings down from me. And so I go in there and, you know, order my drink and say union strong and all of that. I think we're up to about 150 or so. Yeah. But here's the problem, of course, right? Winning a union doesn't mean, you know, you still have to go through the negotiation process. And so they are dragging their feet, both Amazon and Starbucks. And frankly, things are going to have to escalate. There are some strike actions. I think there's going to have to be more of that, you know, easy for me to say from the sidelines, but you're going to have that kind of confrontation, because I don't see the NLRB is, you know, better under Biden, certainly, but I don't think, you know, these bosses will continue to drag their feet, and we need folks to step up and really take these places on.
I think Schultz, the CEO of Starbucks last week, said that he would never negotiate with the unions.
And you know, I think I completely agree with Chad. I think the foot dragging works to the employer's advantage, and the law in many ways supports that. Time is on their side. The law also limits the kind of militancy that these workers can engage in. It limits their potential to mobilize kind of solidarity-based actions in support of themselves, in support of their efforts here. They're in a tough position, and they're going to need the kind of fortitude that has up until now, since the post-war, through the post-war period, been sorely lacking in the labor movement. I guess easy for me to say. I'm not out there. I don't work at Starbucks. I'm not likely going to get arrested on a picket line. In front of a Starbucks, but they're going to need that kind of militancy and fortitude, and it may put them in violation of the law, and that's not a small thing. And I also agree with you, Bob, you put your finger on it again, that it's going to be tough to rebuild the labor movement 10 or 15 workers at a time. That's something else that's conditioned by the law in the way it limits your ability to organize across an entire employer, like Starbucks, let alone a whole industry anymore. And so that's going to be tough, and it'll be tough in the face of government policies, including a potential recession, one rooted in monetary policies designed to tame inflation. But we'll see. I mean, I wish them the best, and I do admire what's been happening in a lot of these workplaces of late.
One thing that's interesting, and I think that's an excellent point, Ahmed. Schultz's comment, you know, we will never negotiate with them. I mean, that's kind of telling, right? I mean, that's, you know, because up to that point, I think he was saying, you know, oh yeah, well, you know, the workers, if they want to do this, you know, we don't think it's a good idea. But now he's coming, he's saying the secret part, you know, in public, right? And so that's, and unions in the, you know, among the public are have a high degree of support, right? More so than you know, in previous times. So there are things on our side. What this will look like, I don't know, but you know, we'll have to see.
Yeah, I've got about 18 more questions, so I'm gonna. I think union acceptance is at the highest it's been in like 40 years. It's something like close to 70% of Americans think that they're kind of useful and necessary. So, but like I said, I have way more that we could talk about, but I really appreciate this. I don't know if Scott has anything to end with, but thank you, Chad, for suggesting this. Thank you, Ahmed, for coming on. I've been reading your stuff for a while, so it's really great to talk to you. And we'll definitely have to get you back on again and kind of follow up if, you know, see what's going on a year from now or whatever. But thanks so much. Really appreciate it. Great history lesson, great political lesson as well. So thank you.
Yeah, much appreciated. Folks, you've been listening to Professor Chad Pearson, Professor Ahmed White. We've been talking about capital's war on workers, radicalism, and unions, et cetera. If you enjoyed this show, check us out on social media, on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. If you're watching this on YouTube, hit the subscribe button. And if you want to make a donation, go to greenandredpodcast.org and hit that support button or become a patron at patreon.com/greenredpodcast. We'll talk to you all again soon. Everyone go out there and misbehave and make a lot of trouble.
I see they're a-lowering, right new coffin. I see they're letting down, right new coffin. Way over in that Union burying ground. And the new dirt's a-falling on a right new coffin. The new dirt's a-falling on a right new coffin. Way over in that Union burying ground. Oh, tell me who's that they're letting down, down. Tell me who's that they're letting down, down. Way over in that Union burying ground. Another union organizer, another union organizer, way over in that union burying ground. A union brother and a union sister, a union brother and a union sister. Way over in that Union burying ground. A Union father and a Union mother, and a Union father and a Union mother. Way over in that Union burying ground. Well, I'm gonna sleep in a Union coffin. I'm gonna sleep in a Union coffin. Way over in that Union burial. burying ground. Every new grave brings a thousand new ones. Every new grave brings a thousand members way over in that Union burying ground. Every new grave brings a thousand brothers, and every new grave brings a thousand sisters to the Union in that Union burying ground.